It's week 5 in the NFL, and we've got questions such as, will Eli be manning the top spot in fantasy for the second consecutive week?
Will the Eagles be more offensive and less offensive to fantasy owners this week?
Relegation in the NFL. Can we just do it for the Jaguars already?
And when Cleveland plays Tennessee, you won't be watching, but who should you be starting?
All these questions and more answered on this week's Fantasy War Room Live.
Groovy.
Folks, it is Wednesday, October 1st. We are through the first month of the football season. It is the quarter mark of the NFL season for almost all teams. Nick's just sitting down with us. I'm Matt Ufford, as always, joined by Nick Stevens. Nick, how are your fantasy teams doing so far? So let's do a little temperature check.
My fantasy teams are kind of like the small fire I just put out in the studio. Hot. Nerve-wracking. Frustrating. They're fantasy teams. There's a reason why we call this fantasy football, because fantasies sometimes come true, and fantasies are often like giant balloons of joy that just get popped right over your head.
Interesting.
And hypodermic needles rain down upon you.
I don't think I've ever had a fantasy like that.
No, you haven't?
No.
Have you? They're like piñatas full of fire ants.
You have some strange fantasies.
Yeah, like empty chip bags that have like tobacco juice in it. Just really, like you reach in and you're like, this is my fantasy. I found chips, and it's just someone's spit. That's what my fantasy teams are like. It's so, you know, maybe I should preface this by saying I am the victim of one of the all-time, one of those classic fantasy, like Liam Neeson from Taken just came in and like karate chopped my fantasy hopes right at midnight, just straight up the other night. Monday night, heading into Monday Night Football, I had what I thought was a shoo-in in my biggest league. I just needed a field goal, 2.3 points from Steven Gostkowski for a big win.
He did not kick a field goal on Monday night.
He kicked two meaningless extra points, and me, right between my own personal dangling footballs. And I lost a huge game by 0.3 points. And that's what it is.
That hurts.
We've all won on stat corrections before. We've won huge games we didn't expect to stage miracle comebacks in. And then we've lost games where we thought, well, Gostkowski's obviously going to get a field goal in Kansas City.
No.
Kansas City, the new hub of the sports universe. Did you know that?
Unfortunately, yes. I have my entire set of in-laws are from Oakland, and it's a very dark day.
Oh, sorry about that.
Well, yes. Between the Raiders and now the A's, it's rough times.
A dark hole out there for years.
True.
You know, that's what they actually call the stadium.
The dark hole.
That was a great movie as a child growing up. So that's me on the fantasy season. How are you doing, sir?
Let's see now. I've got six teams. Mm-hmm. Four of them look like world beaters.
Six teams. Wow.
Yeah, this is what I do. This is my job, Nick. Six teams. It's too much, and I hate my life because of it. Four of them are terrific winning teams. One's 2-2, and my foray into the auction world has not gone well. That team is 0-4, and it's just one of those teams where everything's gone wrong. My running backs are Monte Ball and Andre Ellington, and it's a deep league too. I don't want to talk about it anymore.
Now let me ask you, as we hit the quarter mark. As we hand the baton off to runner number two in the relay race that is the fantasy season, who are the biggest busts, who are the most pleasant surprises, and who would you say you see coming through or regaining form as we start to head towards like the middle when things really just sort of like get on track?
You know, obviously, LeSean McCoy jumps out as someone who's been a disappointment so far. I do anticipate him to turn that around. We'll get into it more with running backs a little bit later on.
Yep.
But I would say if I were a Cordarrelle Patterson owner, and I'm not in any of my leagues, but he has had one terrific game, three pretty disappointing games, and there are no real signs of him being more integrated into that offense. I would be very upset if I used a third or a fourth round draft pick on him. And that's really what sticks out to me. Let's shall we delve into the position rankings?
Yeah, I was just going to say the one. You know, one thing that's actually a bit of a bummer to me is that we don't really have. I mean, the RB1s, of course, we talked last week about the fact that, you know, with Peterson suspended, McCoy being a bit of disappointment, Forte really not regaining form. Lacy scores a touchdown but only gets 50 yards last week, and we're all excited about it. The consensus top six or seven RB1s have been a disappointment. But also, there aren't really any new fantasy stars. We're just spinning a lot of the same old wheels and kind of recycling a lot of names. I would say outside of Kelvin Benjamin, nobody is really burning bright in the fantasy sky for me right now that has popped on the scene and said, surprise, it's me.
I mean, DeMarco Murray had an excellent season last year, so he's not really a new face.
Right.
Steve Smith, back from the dead, I think that's an interesting storyline. And although I do think that he's probably going to fall off as the season goes on a little bit. But there's not really a whole bunch of rookie shakeup. I think we're going to see Bishop Sankey start to take the load in Tennessee.
That's what I was thinking.
That could turn things around a little bit for the Titans.
That's great.
Something needs to happen in Tennessee because that team is,
I'm just excited about the fact that you said take the load.
Yes, indeed. All right, let's talk quarterbacks. Your quarterback rankings are, as always, something that's a delight. And I don't have a ton of arguments here. You've got Aaron Rodgers at the top. He was back in form in a fantastic way last week. Drew Brees at the second spot. He hasn't been his usual self, which is saying a lot for someone who's still throwing 300 yards per game and two touchdowns every game. Eli Manning, fresh off being the number one fantasy play in all of the NFL last week. And he's in your three spot versus an Atlanta team that gives up plenty of yards through the air, followed by Romo, Roethlisberger, Peyton Manning, all the way down at number six because of the Cardinals defense, although he is at home, and then you've got Matt Ryan at seven. And I don't have a ton of that. I think that there are two names missing from your top seven or eight, and they're down at 9 and 10. Phillip Rivers. Phillip Rivers has, I believe, an 8-1 or a 9-1. 9-1 touchdown to interception ratio this year. And he's only started in 55% of Yahoo leagues.
I don't get that.
That's unthinkable to me. Maybe he was only drafted by people who have Peyton Manning. I don't know. I don't know what that story is.
You know, there was that predominant line of thinking that if you weren't going to go for one of the elite QBs, that you could really get some big bang in the fifth through the eighth rounds. There would be a lot of value, and you'd probably be one of those Cutler Romo guys, or maybe you'd be a Rivers and Roethlisberger type of guy. How in the world now you're either not always starting Rivers, or you haven't decided to spin him for an RB1 because somebody else is getting frustrated with McCoy, or maybe somebody else is like, I'm tired of dragging Eddie Lacy's rear end out of bed and reminding him he's got to go to school and do his homework every day.
Yeah.
So he's been huge. Look at that. Three touchdowns against Seattle. I could throw four touchdowns in my sleep against Jacksonville, but four touchdowns, four of the ugliest and still yet most counting touchdowns. It's 2 years into his renaissance.
Yeah.
He's great.
I think we were all saying, oh, he's going to have to regress this year. He has not. He looks fantastic. And his wide receiver core is more healthy. Keenan Allen is back from the dead. And then Eddie Royal and Malcolm Floyd look great, too.
I know.
And Antonio Gates refuses to die.
It's been nice, though. There hasn't been a stiff breeze in San Diego because, you know, when there is a stiff breeze, Malcolm Floyd tears his hamstring.
Yeah. Also, Phillip Rivers' passes sail out of the stadium. Get caught in an updraft. They're just gone.
I know. I saw three kids with old Nintendo pistols playing, shooting at Phillip Rivers' passes. They are wobbling ducks. Phillip Rivers, and he is playing this week at home where he plays extremely well, better as most quarterbacks do because they love their home cooking. And it's against the Jets, who continue to not be able to, though it is only four games into the season, they have not solved their secondary issue whatsoever.
No, I think that you've got a great shot at... It's a little bit of the conundrum that we used to have with the Saints with the wide receiver core. It's like, who's going to get the benefit of the touchdowns? It could be Malcolm Floyd on some deep balls this week because the Jets secondary is that bad. Or is it going to be Eddie Royal on the short passes in the red zone? Or is it going to give Keenan Allen his due? I don't know.
We can get into that. I've got a whole spiel saved for wide receiver.
But regardless, the Jets, who are leading the NFL with 14 sacks, So if they can get to Phillip Rivers, maybe they can make some things happen. But a great rushing defense, mm-hmm. and the Chargers have no rushing offense right now with Ryan Matthews injured, Danny Woodhead injured, and Donald Brown playing horribly.
What?
Yes.
Donald Brown not playing up to expectation. God damn it, Donald!
One of the greatest sound bites of all time. Pardon my French. I hope I didn't offend anybody there. Phillip Rivers could vault his way into the top five this week against the Jets. But one thing that's actually helping San Diego on the whole and giving Phillip Rivers the time he needs to engage year two of the Phillip Rivers Renaissance, or the PRR as I like to call it, is the fact that they finally have a really good offensive line out there.
Yeah.
Their center went out. Rich Ornberger, a former Patriots swing tackle guy, has come in, done really well. Thank God the Pats got rid of him. He's played pretty well.
There's been some troubles with the first snaps when he first came in. I think they had two or three fumbled snaps when he first came in.
But since then,
should be much better.
And King Dunlap, one of my favorite names of all time.
It's a good one.
It's a great name.
How about at number 10, Andrew Luck, all the way down at 10. You must have a lot of respect for the Ravens defense. Because Andrew Luck has 13 touchdowns through the air plus one on the ground through four games, mm-hmm. averaging something like 326 yards per game.
Mm-hmm.
He's good. He's real good.
Yeah, he's.
It's no longer just like the big three, and then maybe Andrew Luck is fourth. It's like, oh, Andrew Luck is here, folks. By the way,
right? Yeah, he and his neckbeard came barging through the door, and they are here to stay. It is pretty awesome.
I really wish the beard wasn't there to stay, though.
It's just, he always looks fresh from a Rumspringa. You know what I mean? Like, it's just got that straight. Anyway, forget about the look. Yes, he's having a tremendous year. And just imagine what he would be doing if he really had, his wide receiving core is good. It's not great. They seem to play up to his level.
Yeah.
Ahmad Bradshaw for the next 3.5 games that he'll enjoy him before mm-hmm. he breaks his foot, neck, or neck foot, or whatever it mm-hmm. is that he sprains.
Neck foot, a very popular graffiti artist in Brooklyn.
He's really good. Yeah, I enjoy mm-hmm. his work. He's great. The Baltimore cornerbacks may just be the right side. That may just be the right kind of secondary. I could see possibly disrupting little tiny T.Y. Hilton and maybe giving Hakeem Nicks, who kind of needs, like, Hakeem Nicks is he's a sailboat that performs extremely well under the proper conditions. But if you do anything to disrupt him, forget it. All is lost. He needs absolute perfect conditions.
He capsizes in rough waters.
Takes on water, and this is just 85 minutes of Robert Redford.
All right, your final five, and the quarterback we got Jay Cutler mm-hmm. at Carolina. 12 is Nick Foles versus St. Louis. He was garbage against the Niners. Oof, man.
Yeah.
That was not fun to see.
That was moldy bread. That was moldy bread crust.
Yeah.
That was really just a pile of yuck. I mean, I can't figure out how in the world, when other teams have shown the way to score against San Francisco, you're not going to put up a 40 spot. You're not going to do it. You know, the quintessential Chip Kelly 35, but to not score an offensive touchdown.
How do you get
negative fantasy points?
You get two special teams and one defensive touchdown, and you still manage to lose. That is that takes real effort.
How about that? It takes a certain kind of special somebody to put that together. How about that stat you dropped on me before the show? The Eagles didn't cross the 50 until the fourth quarter.
Yeah, no, that was not good on their part.
That was ugly. Well, you've banged this drum before, and I've been listening, and now I think I'm even going to put some guitar and vocals to it. Nick Foles is
not
the drawback.
Good.
No, he's not good.
he's going to have great games because of the Eagles' offense, but with the regression we've seen in the offensive line because of injuries and suspensions, they do get Lane Johnson back this week, the mm-hmm. Eagles do. That should help him, both Foles and LeSean McCoy. Mm-hmm. But yeah, Nick Foles is the weak link in that Eagles offense. Number 13, Colin Kaepernick. Talk about massive talent and just not all that reliable. Mm-hmm. You see, like he can make a perfect throw a couple times a game, and then he makes several terrible ones throughout the course of a game.
Yeah, if Brett Favre were tatted up and related to a bird, I would say that's the way Kaepernick plays.
Yeah.
Like, he reminds me, just like, you've got all this talent, and you just, again, no matter what, obviously, someone's either tuned Harbaugh out, or this is just the reason why Kaepernick fell to the second round, and people didn't want to come within earshot of him, because he's got all the talent in the world, but he continues to try to work outside scheme and force things that you just, like, when the ball leaves his hand, you're just like, I absolutely is going to sail into the sidelines or an opponent's arms. I just won't play a conservative game.
And if he did, he'd be a much more successful quarterback.
Rounding out the top 15 are Cam Newton versus Chicago and Joe Flacco versus Indianapolis. Mm-hmm. And Nick, where's Russell Wilson on this list? Russell Wilson playing Monday night at Washington. The Washington football team is giving up the fifth most fantasy points to quarterbacks, and that's with two of their games being against Ryan Fitzpatrick and Chad Henne. They just gave up 34 odd fantasy points to Eli Manning. I think Russell Wilson will be a top 10 quarterback this week.
Yeah, but I was thinking, you know, by the time they take Russell Wilson out when it's 48-0 in the second quarter because Marshawn Lynch has gone capital beast mode, it's a bit of an oversight. But also, I can't see, I probably would put him in the 12-13 range. Again, yes, the Washington is just god-awful against opposing quarterbacks, the way that they literally revived the New York offense. They let New York actually work out plays so that Eli could scheme and understand this new West Coast offense better. They made Larry Donald this week's end must-pick-up superstar. He almost caught four touchdowns. After the third one, wouldn't you have thought, okay, they're in the red zone, cover the tight end? No. Only pass interference in the end zone prevented it. Unbelievable.
I think Russell Wilson, we're looking at 220 yards passing through the air, because it's not that much. Three touchdowns, and then an extra 40 or so yards on the ground.
I see him in the, I call it that, where I see Russell Wilson being sort of the Chuck Woolery zone, 2-2, 200 yards, two touchdowns.
Okay. I mean, it's just, the Redskins are in for a handful on Monday night, and we just don't know where those scores are coming from in the Seattle offense. So who knows, maybe it's Percy Harvin's day.
I especially think it could be Percy Harvin's day.
All right, that wraps our quarterback talk. I think we'll get back to, towards the end of the show, we'll talk a little bit about the rookie quarterbacks making their second starts. But for now, let us move on to running backs. And this has been a murky situation, with the exception of DeMarco Murray, who every single week has rushed for over 100 yards and at least one score. Marshawn Lynch is a great second play at Washington. He's getting it done every week with the same kind of regularity that Murray has been. After that, you've got McCoy. You've got some faith in LeSean McCoy. As we noted, he's going to get Lane Johnson back from suspension this week, so the Eagles offensive line should stabilize a little bit. But he has 29 carries for 39 yards in the last 2 weeks, zero catches. And you have to think that Chip Kelly is going to make an adjustment to, if he's not getting the ball anywhere, if he's not moving the ball on the ground, give him some screens or something like that. Like if he's getting met in the backfield by opposing defenders, we got to get him some screens. Don't throw all those to Darren Sproles. I don't understand.
I don't get it either. And this will probably be the last, if he underperforms again, I think this is going to be the last week that we see McCoy as a top five rated running back. There have been a lot of people, obviously, mostly in the social media world, who have just been getting their grouse on about the fact that McCoy hasn't pointed significantly this year because everybody spent their first or second pick overall on him. If there's ever been a matchup, they're home. They're coming off of a loss. They were embarrassed on the road.
The Rams are giving up 5.1 yards per carry.
The Rams front seven is dinged up big time. This seems like the plum perfect time to get him 27 carries, 120 yards, and two touchdowns so that everyone can just go, ah, oh, that's more like it.
Yeah, I agree. And four, Rashad Jennings versus Atlanta. At home against the Falcons. The Falcons just allowed Matt Asiata and Jerick McKinnon to run for 200-plus yards. Yeah, Rashad Jennings is a great. There's some people, I'm seeing some serious concern that because Andre Williams came on to run for 66 or 68 yards in a score last week, that you've got to pick up Andre Williams because Rashad Jennings isn't going to get the work. No, Rashad Jennings stopped carrying the ball because the Giants were beating the snot out of the Redskins, and Tom Coughlin let the rookie take some of the beating.
It was 38-14. You want to get him some game experience, number one.
Yeah.
Number two, it was 38-14. Number three, Kirk Cousins had just thrown his 17th interception of the second half.
An NFL record.
The game was in hand, pocket and backpack at that point.
Yeah.
It was signed, sealed, and delivered. No, Smash Williams just got a little relief duty. A little garbage time, a little GT.
Yeah.
All good. Rashad Jennings has been tremendous. Top five running back.
Yeah, absolutely.
He's been one of the more pleasant surprises on the season.
And when we were talking and doing our little mini state of the Fantasy Union through 4 weeks earlier, one of the things I talked about how the RB1s or the especially the first five or six had been kind of bumming me out a little bit, and most people in general. The RB2s, the guys who you drafted to be your RB2 probably, mm-hmm. who you were hoping would just give you 7 to 9 points a week. Guys like Le'Veon Bell, guys like
Rashad Jennings.
Guys like even Giovanni Bernard have all been doing a bang-up job.
Andre Ellington, who has been banged up but has actually done pretty well despite that. He hasn't been in the end zone yet. He will. Mm-hmm. Andre Ellington I still have faith in. Someone who I would not put on that list is Toby Gerhardt.
No. Nope.
And that's all we have to say about Toby Gerhardt.
And Moving on. Toby Gerhardt appeared last week in your fantasy line. And that was that.
Moving on, you've got Le'Veon Bell at Jacksonville. Mm-hmm. That is one of the easier, better plays mm-hmm. throughout the week. Listen, play if you've got any position against Jacksonville, I want to point out how bad Jacksonville is. They're giving up the most fantasy points to quarterbacks, the second most fantasy points to wide receivers, mm-hmm. the third most fantasy points to running backs, third most against tight ends, most to kickers, most to defenses. There's not anything that Jacksonville does well.
No. Jacksonville, when you, like, okay, Pittsburgh this week is coming off of a real emotional karate chop to the dude region of a loss mm-hmm. to Tampa Bay with that Mike Glennon to Vincent Jackson pass in the last 10 seconds. Mm-hmm. That's a tough one. When you have that kind of real-life NFL hangover, what do you need? What do you need when you have a wicked hangover?
The Jaguars. You need that green drink.
No, forget that. I'm putting on weight today to just get past how I feel. I'm going everything bagel, cream cheese, Bloody Mary, and I need like one of the diehards on TNT. I'm just full day on the sofa getting fat, and that is what the Jaguars are.
I go full out. I go full on bacon, egg, and cheese sandwich, mm-hmm. And then like a huge green drink that tastes awful, mostly like kale and parsley and some lime juice. And I eat all that, and then I go back to sleep.
And then you sleep it off, and you just let all those those phytonutrients do their work.
Do its thing. No. That's the Jacksonville Jaguars.
Oh no, I just do everything terrible. I'm talking like get the everything bagel with cream cheese. I may open it up and pour a bag of Cool Ranch Doritos on top of it. I'll get in, dude. I'm the guy that ate hallway pizza. What do you expect? I am a 6'1" Irish Greek raccoon. I'm an embarrassment, and I am not ashamed to admit it.
All right, I don't think we need to. You have Eddie Lacy versus Minnesota next at number six.
They're top bottom 10 against the run.
Lacy 17 for 48 last week with a touchdown, another one called back because of a holding call. Mm-hmm. I'm not too worried about Eddie Lacy, not because he's going to be fine. He's looking good. He might have a serious case of Trent Richardsonitis. I don't know. He does not look good, but I'm not concerned because that's the Packers' offense, and as long as he's getting carries inside the 3-yard line, I don't really care.
So if you're a brick dude house of a human who carries the football for Nick Saban and you've got dreadlocks and you get drafted in the first round, you're going to have a good half a season then just suck?
I don't know. There's certainly a precedent there.
I don't say it isn't so. And they come in threes, which means there's another one to come. Oh, TJ Yeldon, keep your hair short, man. I think there's probably a little health and maybe some continuity. Again, it's something, we talked about it earlier. This is what's killing the Patriots. It's what's helping Philip Rivers. I think this is also going to be what helps Green Bay. As they remain healthy, as their offensive line has stability and continuity, that's going to allow Eddie Lacy to run more like Marshawn Lynch, which is just sort of like, the way Eddie Lacy attacked the offensive line last year, it's like he had, what did you just say about my mother? And then just came at people and just came at the line. As opposed to the way they used to say, like, like Brandon Jacobs, like for a guy that size, they used to say like he ran like he had he was wearing a towel and just came out of the shower and was trying to answer the phone. You know what I mean? Just that. Excuse me. I think we'll see a return to form for Eddie Lacy. Big Thursday night for him and the Packers in general.
I want to skip down the rankings a little bit.
Sure.
Down to number 13 and a pleasant surprise for fantasy owners. Jamal Charles is
Jamal
at San Francisco.
Charles.
I think I don't want to put too much weight on the 3 touchdowns and the 108 yards from scrimmage he had against the Patriots, because I don't want to just base on what just happened. But 13th is a little bit low for a guy who we expect to be good. I was super worried about that high ankle sprain. He did not look like a man who was hurt at all.
Mm-mm.
He looked fantastic.
He did. He looked the best he's looked since like early last year.
Yeah.
Looked really like, he looked like somebody who hadn't taken a lot of hits, who trusted his line. And again, this is another thing. Eric Fisher growing into the, like, starting to look like a real left tackle in the NFL, starting to look like somebody who should have gone number one overall. Their offensive line is gelling. It makes all the difference in the world. Back in the day when all those running backs used to put up monstrous numbers pre and then during the heyday of early 2000s fantasy, it was always about the fact that Willie Roaf was a turretless tank that would just pull out and lead block.
Yep.
So their line's coming together. Jamal Charles looks great. Niall Davis looks fantastic as well.
Niall Davis also had 100 yards rushing.
I know. Did you know he was actually the strongest football player on the Arkansas football team? He could out-bench press every single person on his offensive and defensive line.
I did not know that.
That is a big, strong man to have backing up one of the quintessential fleet-footed sort of Marshall Faulk fantasy back.
Yeah,
he's awesome.
He's great.
Great combo.
I expect him to have, again, San Francisco is a tough defense, but I think he'll be fine.
That's why I have him ranked a little bit lower, because we did just see, even though they were a little dinged up on the line themselves, we did just see LeSean McCoy go for LeSean McNothing. So.
And then number 16, C.J. Spiller, gets a very tough matchup at Detroit. But I will say, it's so strange for me to say positive things about Kyle Orton, but what a huge step up Kyle Orton is from E.J. Manuel.
Kyle Orton, his resume. You know how Tom Brady posted his resume on the internet a few weeks ago? Mm-hmm. I was like, oh, that's so funny. Kyle Orton posted his. Do you know what it said right beneath the address?
What's that?
Not E.J. Manuel. I think this is actually, he played really well last year in that, played very well actually in that game until he, until like the little Broadway playbill said, and now starring in the fourth quarter in the part of Tony Romo will be Kyle Orton, and he threw that awful interception. He played pretty well for the Cowboys last year. He's a capable quarterback.
Yeah.
He is a perfectly good, especially you give him some young weapons. He's got a good running game.
Sammy Watkins takes a huge tick up in my book.
He could be the guy joining Kelvin Benjamin in the new fantasy superstar club.
I'd like that.
I would too.
Speaking of new fantasy superstars, that's probably not accurate to say about this next one. But at 19, you've got Bishop Sankey playing versus Cleveland. Coach Ken Wisenhunt confirmed that Sankey will get more touches this week.
Mm-hmm.
So goodbye, Sean Green. It was no fun having you on any team at all. Bishop Sankey finally getting his due. He had, I think, 70 or so yards plus a touchdown last week. I'm very excited to see him actually get a little bit more of a workload.
What was the over-under on number of games we would actually mention Sean Green? It had to have been 3.5, right?
Yeah, it was. We basically hit it right on.
Right on.
Halfway through
between weeks 3 and 4, we're like, now we can stop caring about him.
Yep.
And also, Ben Tate I have in the right now. I know he's questionable, but he has been practicing. Now, here we are broadcasting live / taping for your listening or viewing pleasure on a Wednesday afternoon from New York City, capital of the world. And Ben Tate has been practicing, and Mike Pettine has said if he continues to practice this well and look as good as he does, he'll get the start on Sunday.
Yeah, I don't know how I feel about Ben Tate. It's just that three-headed monster, because Isaiah Crowell's been, I think he had over 5 yards per carry, more touchdowns than even
Terrence West.
Terrence West. Thank you.
He's getting the they've had their little thunder and lightning combo going. Terrence West will get the yards, then Crowell comes in and gets the touchdowns and vultures up all the points.
So that's sort of the thing where now we got the three-headed monster, and it's like I would prefer not to be involved with that. I don't want to get too involved, too heavily invested in any one of those running backs because I don't know, that's going to be a fluid situation throughout the season. It's like being, if you've got a Ravens running back this season. Oh, it's Bernard Pierce. Just kidding. It's Justin Forsett. Oh, just kidding. It's Taliaferro. Take that away from me. I don't want it. Just give me somebody who does nothing with 20 carries a game. Like, that's just what I want.
Yeah. Nobody loves, Greek mythology and monster movies are great for hydras or three-headed dogs at the gate to hell. Fantasy, not so much.
Not interested.
Nope.
Let's round up the running back discussion with your 20th pick, Jerick McKinnon. You're putting him ahead of Matt Asiata. Now, obviously, I think Jerick McKinnon is the better long-term investment. He's clearly the more electric, elusive back. But
7.5 YPC last week.
He had 18 carries for 135, I think. But I think that you're not going to see that kind of production from him every week. I think Matt Asiata is still going to be good for 18 carries every week and a lot more passes caught. The Vikings love that love Asiata as a pass blocker, mm-hmm. where McKinnon isn't up to speed yet. And they like Asiata as a pass catcher as well. So you're going to see Asiata with his 18 carries for 60 yards.
18 carries for 49 yards.
49.
He's going to put up an Eddie Lacy.
But he's going to get every goal line carry, mm-hmm. and he's going to get an extra 4 to 6 catches for another 30 or 40 yards.
Right. I mean, Asiata is, I mean, like, to me, he's like Hawaiian Sean Green, just somebody who I shouldn't have to care about that much longer.
I don't think he's actually Hawaiian.
Same thing. Whatever. It's fine. Close enough. He looks like an extra from Forgetting Sarah Marshall. I don't care. Jerick McKinnon to me, this is a new Washington Redskins dynamic to me, because Jerick McKinnon looks like somebody who's got the speed, he's got the moves, looks like he's very fast, literally bursting onto the scene last week. Great combine, a lot of hype on him. It's good to finally see it happen. Yes, it did come against one of those three hangover remedy. Mm-hmm. You know,
the Falcons are terrible against the run.
You know, pint of Ben and Jerry's and Shawshank on TV. Mm-hmm. Remedy. Whenever you play Washington, Jacksonville, or Atlanta, you start everybody.
Yep.
So yes, that's how he burst onto the scene. And no, it's not going to be as easy against Green Bay, considering that they're actually a top 12 rushing defense. But at the same time, Asiata he's like a Roy Helu. He's a Darrell Young. That's why I made the comparison to Washington. Like, he'll somehow get the touchdowns, but can you really rely on that?
So far, you can.
Yeah, I guess so. Oh, touchdowns matter. That's right. I forgot.
All right, let's wrap on running backs. Okay. Let us now discuss wide receivers. Antonio Brown is the most obvious number one choice possible. Mm-hmm. Fantastic week last week. And that was with him dropping a flea flicker that would have been a 60-yard touchdown.
73-yarder.
73-yard.
Bomb, and it was placed
right in his hands.
Perfectly.
And
Stevie Johnson tweeted at God. He was so upset about that one.
It's and if it was anybody but Antonio Brown, we would hate him for that.
Right.
But because he's so amazing, and he already scored 2 touchdowns that day, hard to be upset about it.
100%. This was last year. He cost Pittsburgh a game because he stepped out of bounds
in
the snow. Yep. This is his 2014 stepping out of bounds in the snow. Mm-hmm. Huge day, cost them a game, but we still love him because, man, is he good at catching the ball, running with it, and karate kicking punters.
And going up against the Jaguars. Yes, please. Next up, Jordy Nelson versus Minnesota, an easy start. Leads the NFL in receiving yards, leads the NFL in targets, leads the NFL in red zone targets. Yeah, I wish I had him on any of my teams. I do not.
Neither do I, which bums me out. I should have been a bigger believer. I've always been a fan of his game. Right now, he's actually on track. He and Antonio Brown and Jordy Nelson are on track to compete for number one overall fantasy receiver in 2014, which if I told you that 6 weeks ago, you would have told me to please not drink as much before I come over to your house for a live draft.
I would have believed you about Antonio Brown. Absolutely.
Maybe top 5, but not number 1.
I believe it. I think that's totally understandable. Antonio Brown is a complete package. Mm-hmm. But Jordy Nelson definitely a surprise. I mean, yeah. Top 5, sure, but mm-hmm. Going down the list, Dez Bryant, Julio Jones, Calvin Johnson, questionable with that ankle injury, but still Calvin Johnson. A.J. Green has coming off a bye week to rest his injured foot a little bit. Mm-hmm. A great play at New England.
Especially if, I would mention this before the show, but the Patriots have done something inconceivably brilliant, which is you pay $12 million a year for Darrelle Revis to come in and shore up your secondary. And what they're doing is that for every $1 million that they've paid him, they're having him play that many yards off the number one receiver of the team.
So you can just that's
mind-boggling.
That's it's almost like Greg Schiano is inhabiting, is inside Bill Belichick's brain operating him. No, zone's the way to go with him.
Yeah, don't those movies usually involve like Judge Reinhold or Kirk Cameron? Like these body swap movies. It's mind-blowing. But yeah, I'd put AJ Green higher if he hadn't recently been injured, or if we had seen a number one receiver go over 100 plus 2 touchdowns against the Patriots.
Yeah.
So I can see him having a solid, dependable top 10 night.
All these receivers that we're talking about right now are starts this week. And mm-hmm. so I would rather blow through this list and then talk about guys that are maybe a little bit outside the top 20.
But I would like to ask you about one top 10 receiver. I think Randall Cobb will do his job. Didn't mean to rhyme, but we're moving on for time. Demaryius Thomas. I have him at seven. Now, here's
a
guy.
Very disappointing start so far.
That's the thing. Where's he been?
He's been getting the targets. He's also had a game against the Seahawks in mm-hmm. which, Julius Thomas was the one to benefit with the, mm-hmm. with the touchdown there. He's been getting looks, but it just hasn't happened for him. He's getting the targets. It's still there. Mm-hmm. But Emmanuel Sanders, mm-hmm. Obviously roaming free and in easier coverage because of him, and Peyton Manning is going with the open man.
Right. So. And this week he draws Patrick Peterson, who promised after he got his big old contract that he was going to be as tough a cover cornerback in the NFL as there is. He's done a good job so far.
Yep. So I think that seven is the right spot for Demaryius Thomas. Keep having faith in him. He's got some tough matchups.
A lot of guys spent some real. They thought about Jimmy Graham and they grabbed Demaryius at 9 or 10 in the first round, probably. Oh, that's how it went off, and he's not played anywhere.
Actually, I think I was one of the people saying like, oh, Demaryius Thomas worth a spot with worth a grab at 10 because he's gonna be the number one wide receiver this year. He'll supplant Calvin Johnson. I have not been proven right about that. Randall Cobb at 9, Brandon Marshall at 10, gimpy ankle, but still getting it done. Didn't get as many targets last week, but still found the end zone. Number 11, someone we talked about last week, Keenan Allen, back with a vengeance in week 4, 10 catches on 11 or 12 targets for 135 yards. Mm-hmm. Keenan Allen's just fine.
We don't even woke up in the second half. It's almost like Keenan Allen heard he put on like that special Cerebro, the helmet that.
He's actually a big fan of the show.
Charles, is he really? Yeah. Keenan Allen's a huge fan of the show. I was gonna go way further into the nerdverse. I was gonna say he put on Cerebro, which is that helmet that Professor X wears in the X-Men, okay. And he heard all the voices of fantasy owners everywhere around the world just saying, "Come on, Keenan, you can do it. I need you, Keenan." It was all in the second, and what it was. Right after Eddie Royal got those two touchdowns, it was just like, that's enough. No, I'm the number one wide receiver on this team.
Yeah.
I think, and against the Jets, perfect week for him to just keep on rolling.
Yeah.
He can go all the way down the field, then Eddie Royal can get the touchdowns, and then I'll burn my apartment down.
Eddie Royal, I hate him so much.
He's done it. Last week I said people were going to race to the waivers and grab him. And some people did, and unfortunately, we advised.
I had to start him because of bye weeks.
You did.
I actually advised. I advised fantasy owners to not start mm-hmm. Eddie Royal, mm-hmm. and then I had to because I had too many guys on bye, and it worked out because he had 100 yards plus two touchdowns, and I hated him for it.
Mm-hmm.
I hated him for helping me.
You hated yourself for it. Too.
Yeah, exactly.
Until you won, and then you were like, "Hey, nice job, me."
Yeah.
You went against your own word, but so what? That's, you know, rarely does that work in fantasy, but you desperate times call for desperate or ridiculous measures.
Yeah.
Eddie Royal now has done the two touchdown Eddie Royal job 2 weeks in a row.
Mm-hmm.
No way in the world should you start. This is not going to happen 3 weeks in a row.
Do you know what Eddie Royal's career high in receiving yardage for a year is?
Cannot be over 600 yards.
As a rookie, he had 900 plus yards for the Broncos in 2008. He has cracked 600 yards two more times.
That's it.
Throughout his career, has never once sniffed like more than 700 yards since his rookie season.
During his breakout year that he had in 2008, and then in 2009, falls completely off the charts.
Yeah. He did score 8 touchdowns last year. He didn't have a ton of yards, but he did score 8 touchdowns.
Like 500 yards and 8 touchdowns. And when you're in but only like 40 catches too. So when you're in a half point PPR league and you want those yards and catches as much as you want the touchdowns,
his value is tied completely to whether he gets in the end zone. He's useless mm-hmm. if he doesn't. And therefore, like, for God's sake, just get rid of him now. Like just don't, you don't want to deal with that.
No.
If you can like sucker someone into like trading like for
right.
him, if you have him and you're like, I don't want this dangerous, volatile thing. I don't want the heartbreak of uneven play week to week.
Mm-hmm.
Just get rid of him. Get rid of him.
That's like having fireworks around.
Yeah.
Yeah, just like... I just,
you don't store your fireworks in your toddler's room, no. You know?
You don't?
No.
You should. Amazing things can happen. By the way, take nothing I've said so far. Not that you do, listeners/viewers, but if you don't want him, just get at that point. You purposely pick up guys like him so that you can package them and trade them when you're looking for high upside guys.
All right, let's cruise through the rest of the top 20 here. You've got Vincent Jackson at 16 at New Orleans. He has been able to find the end zone, but has otherwise looked kind of this year. Manny Sanders versus Arizona. He's been great. He's a great, great mid-round pickup if you got him. Terrence Williams with a breakout game against New Orleans.
Two touchdowns.
I believe I pointed out that the Saints were giving up 10.2 fantasy points per game to wide receiver twos last week. So.
Uh-oh, and wait a second. The Matt Ufford, president of the Matt Ufford Backpatting Society, is about to just get a whole lot backpattier, everybody.
Yes.
Because who do I have at number 19 but someone that you predicted last week would be a top five wide receiver?
And I was wrong. He was actually a top two wide receiver last week. Steve Smith Sr.
You're going to get tennis elbow from patting yourself on the back so much.
Rounding out the top 20, you've got Percy Harvin at Washington. I think that's a right place for him. Again, with Harvin, he only had 43 yards or so in week three. That was to be predicted. The Broncos were going to set out to stop him. He's used as a decoy in the Seahawks offense a lot. I think that against a team like the Redskins, it's only going to take like two jet sweeps or one bubble screen for him to find the end zone.
The closest thing that they had to a human being that could cover wide receivers went out week two with a torn Achilles for the season. And D'Angelo Hall was hardly exactly who I would consider a top-flight cornerback. So look what the Giants did. The Giants came in with their pop-gun offense, or at least that's what we expected it to be heading into that game, and went off for 45 points and could have pushed it to 52 if they tried really hard.
Yeah.
What do you think Seattle – I mean, Marshawn, huge night. Russell, again, good night. I could see Percy Harvin with a rushing touchdown, a return touchdown, six catches, 80 yards. Never know.
I'd be okay with that.
Sure.
One last quick note. I think Brian Quick, if you've got a PPR league, is a nice matchup against Philly this week.
Thought about that.
I'd give him a look this week if you need that PPR play. If one of your Dolphins or Raiders wide receivers is on bye.
We're gonna Andre Holmes, Brian Hotline. do you know last week when I was talking about fantasy dumpster diving, and you know, that last week was a great week because six teams were on bye and a lot of people were really in a hole when it came to like finding a flex or something like that. Some people had to make some really tough choices and cut players they hope would, make their waivers so they could put them back on the practice squad, aka their fantasy team's bench.
Yeah.
And guys like Ben Tate ended up getting cut because
Brian
Quick got cut off a lot and was available in a lot of Yahoo leagues. I went in and scooped him up all around the board now, and now that gives you great wide receiver and running back depth.
Yeah, I could not agree more. All right, that's our wide receiver talk for week five.
Top shelf wide receiver talk at that.
Thank you. Let's talk tight ends. Number one is somebody named Jimmy Graham. I think that's a pretty good it's a pretty good decision every single week. Number two, Julius Thomas, 5 touchdowns. I think he has something ridiculous like 11 touchdowns in his last 11 games or more. He just gets in the end zone all the time.
Arizona, also one of those teams. They a good overall defense, but tight ends move the ball and make points.
True.
Against the Cardinals.
Number three, Martellus Bennett. Guess what? He has more fantasy points per game than Jimmy Graham.
Pretty impressive, huh?
Yeah.
Mr. Martellus Bennett.
And I think with Brandon Marshall's ankle injury, he's going to continue to be a guy who finds the end zone and is productive in that great Bears offense. Number four, you got Gronk versus Cincy. He scored 3 times in 4 games.
See, even though Gronk is having what people are considering to be a disappointing, I mean, everything in New England is disappointing up to this point. I mean, even people are complaining about their donkeys not tasting right up in New England. It's just a disaster. Gronk scoring in 3 out of 4 games, getting healthier. Garbage. Here's the funny thing, ugly is still not a stat, and garbage time touchdowns count just as much as regular touchdowns.
I would be looking at, down here at number 6, Larry Donnell versus Atlanta, a weak defense. He's getting all of the red zone targets. Mm-hmm. He's just getting all of them. And I'm biased because like I picked him up in one league and he wasn't really expecting much, and then 3 touchdowns against the Redskins. Yeah, don't cover the tight end. Good job, Redskins.
Why don't you cover the tight end? Especially when he's already caught 3 touchdowns and could have had 4.
Anyway.
Very impressive. Where did he go to school, by the way?
I have no idea.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I could sit here all, I could list off every school. Nope.
Nope.
Could have been McNeese State, could have been Auburn. Don't know.
No idea.
Nope.
Although that's also indicative of what I know about college football, too.
Exactly. But these things happen, though. Like, every year there's five or six tight ends that always lead the pack, and then somebody just comes from out of nowhere and turns into that point machine.
Number 7, Greg Olsen versus Chicago. Mm-hmm. Jordan Cameron at Tennessee. He's been very, very quiet this year.
I have not enjoyed that. Don't even own him in any teams, but I like
him. Yeah, because I like consistency. I like feeling like I know what to expect in fantasy, and when someone who is a proven commodity turns, like, disappears, it bothers me.
Yeah, you know, sometimes it's just night. We just want to sit down and just have, like, mom's meatloaf and potatoes.
In your rankings here, the only one I've got some beef with is number 10, Heath Miller at Jacksonville. We have established if you're playing against Jacksonville, you deserve a top 3 ranking, period.
I can't make Heath Miller a top 3.
He just had 9 catches for, I think, 83 yards and a touchdown last week. He was great last week.
He was. And now he's going to Jacksonville.
He can't be a top 3 tight end.
You can't be.
No, not in good conscience. I understand.
It's like asking. No, it's absolutely not. But top 10, though.
Yeah, Zach Ertz versus St. Louis, sure. Antonio Gates versus the Jets.
Zach Ertz, quiet, too.
Yeah, well, that's the entire, your Foles effect.
Mm-hmm.
So I think Zach Ertz will be fine. Delanie Walker has been a top 3 fantasy tight end this year, top 4, top 5.
Mm-hmm.
At least second in receiving yards, or first in receiving yards among tight ends.
Right.
Just behind Jimmy Graham. And I do think that he's going to fall off. Like, I'm not investing.
Delanie Walker?
That's
what he does.
Because, yeah, it's what he does. And you've also got Jake Locker banged up. Mm-hmm. And then Charlie Whitehurst stepping in.
Charles Whitehurst.
Nashville Jesus.
Delanie Walker and Jared Cook, little in fact, share DNA.
Oh.
They do this every year. They start hot and then just disappear.
And rounding out the top 15, Owen Daniels at Indianapolis.
Mm-hmm.
Colts are 28th in the league in fantasy points allowed to tight ends. And I mean that as they're bad at covering tight ends.
Right.
So a good start, even though Owen Daniels didn't get any fantasy points for the assist he gave to Steve Smith last week. That's a shame. He deserved like half a point for
he
that.
He did, yeah. The half point assist PPR. PPR.
All right, that's your tight end discussion for the week. Let's talk about defense and special team units.
Shall we?
Let's make it quick because there's not a whole lot to get into.
Mm-mm.
Seattle at Washington is your number one.
No
obviously.
Brainer.
If Cousins can throw 4 picks against the Giants, he can throw at least 12. 12, that's probably expecting a little bit too much. Chargers versus the Jets.
Mm-hmm.
That's a vote against Geno, I believe.
It is.
Mm-hmm. All right. And then Cincinnati at New England. Yes, the NFL's top-ranked pass defense going up against Tom Brady and his career low 5.8 yards per attempt.
The only quarterback Tom Brady is throwing has a yards per pass completion ratio, whatever the damn stat is.
The only one he's better than is
EJ Manuel.
Ooh.
And EJ Manuel just lost his job to a guy who became famous for taking a picture of having whiskey and vomit running down his shirt.
Well, you know, that's
it was a pretty funny.
That's why we love Kyle Orton.
That's why we love Kyle Orton.
I'm gonna pick out some of the ones that I like.
Mm-hmm.
Number 6, you've got Cleveland at Tennessee. I love starting Cleveland this week, whether it's Jake Locker banged up or Nashville Jesus under center. I like the Browns defense a lot this year, and I don't like the Titans offense that much. And of course, Pittsburgh at Jacksonville.
Mm-hmm.
I do think I have just a shred of belief in the Jaguars offense with Blake Bortles.
Mm-hmm.
I think
that hasn't looked terrible.
He's looked pretty good, actually.
Yeah.
And I think that as he gets more comfortable, I think that this is a Jaguars team. I don't know what to expect out of the Steelers week to week.
No.
That completely uneven.
Mm-hmm.
And Steelers go on the road. Who's to say? I'm not going to do anything crazy like pick the Jaguars to win, but like, who's to say that the Jaguars can't score 27, 28 points?
Listen, Pittsburgh should win this game, and they'll probably even cover the spread. The reason why I would consider starting this defense, it's not like you have Miami or Oakland as your starting defense, and so you're on the bye, and quick, I need a substitute fill in.
Sure.
It's, you know, the Pittsburgh defense is like, you know, it's like ice cream that you picked up at the grocery store, and right before you get it into the freezer at home, it's like that sort of like semi-frozen. Like, it's pretty soft. You can actually do a lot against them. Obviously, look at the way Pencil Neck Glennon was able to carve them up in the end of the game last
week.
And
they've had some bad injuries, too.
They've had some rough injuries, but here's the thing. Bortles still could throw a couple of picks. They could easily, you could easily see a couple sacks and a pick six, which is why they would probably get enough points to warrant being a top 10 defense, even though on any other week you wouldn't want to start.
Absolutely. Let's see, who else do I like here in this list? You've got Dallas as a top 10 team. They do have an injury to Bruce Carter, which is going to affect Dallas's defense. Although, again, against Ryan Fitzpatrick, it's not a bad bet per se. And then
AFC South needs some quarterback help.
You've got Buffalo at 13, Philadelphia versus St. Louis at 14, and then rounding out the top 15, Giants versus ATL. If there's a beef I have anywhere in there, I would say Houston probably deserves to be on there. And I know the Cowboys have a fantastic offense. They're probably going to score their points. But DeMarco Murray's fumbled plenty of the season. You've got the best defensive player in the NFL on the Texans, and the Cowboys have 7 giveaways in 4 games. Mm-hmm. So I would say Texans probably belong on that list too.
3 of those were the first half jitters in the kickoff game against San Francisco for one Mr. Anthony Romo, who has looked a whole lot un-Romo-esque ever since then, which has been great. Or I mean, yeah, it's been vintage Romo, the good kind, the one that you rarely see.
Yeah.
Houston's defense, it's good. It's good to very good at times too, but Dallas plays really, by and large, they play very well at home. I could see their offensive line is the true strength of the team. I can see J.J. Watt being not getting a lot of sack action this week. Just thinking they won't do much.
Okay.
And the Giants, Matty Ice threw 2 interceptions last week. He threw a lot of touchdowns. He threw 3 touchdowns too. But I could see the Giants, maybe if he's going to be handing the ball out, why not?
All right. Sure.
There it is.
Yeah, I don't have strong feelings about defenses that way. All right, we got just a couple minutes for questions at the end of the show. From our good friend, Feck, the mighty Fecklar, says, is Breeze going to get it figured out, or do I risk my hopes on Jay Cutler?
Ooh, do I start Cutler in Carolina over Drew Breeze at home against Tampa Bay?
Drew Breeze at home. And again, Drew Brees doesn't have it figured out. He's had 2 bad road games. He's also thrown for 300 yards, 2 touchdowns, and that's bad for him. Start Drew Brees at home.
Yeah.
He's gonna get it done.
Though Pittsburgh did go into Carolina a couple weeks ago, and Big Ben had himself a pretty good game. So did both of the running backs.
You're looking at longer odds for a hopefully sliver of a better result. Take the safe bet. Drew Brees is still the safe bet. Yeah. I like Jay Cutler a lot. He starts for a couple of my teams, but no.
Stick with Breeze.
Hot Wing Jack at Hot Wing Jack.
God, he was so psyched when he got that name. Hey, you know what he orders when you go out with him?
Burgers.
Quesadillas.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good old Hot. We can always count on Hot Wing Jack for a chicken quesadilla.
He loves sliders. he wants to know Bishop Sankey versus Cleveland or Ben Tate versus Tennessee. Oof, man, that is too invested in one game that I do not want to watch.
Wow, somebody should have drafted a running back before the 4th round in their league.
I'm going to take Sankey.
Yeah.
And I'm not trying to oversell Sankey here because Lord knows that there's still a ton of Titans running backs and Ken Wisenhunt hasn't really made up his mind yet. But I think that just with Ben Tate's status still up in the air.
Right.
I'm going to go with Sankey as a safer bet, you know?
We've got health concerns. There is the touchdown vulture. The Crowell could fly in within the 5 and grab himself another hot bag of 6. Sankey's going to be getting more touches. We said we don't have to worry about Sean Green anymore, and you can run against Cleveland.
Yep. All right, Evan Flugrat wants to know... don't laugh. It's
what Flugrat?
Will Pierre Garçon ever have consistent weeks back-to-back? This is becoming the 2nd season in a row I've suffered this. I'm anti-Pierre Garçon, so I don't know what his production's like on a week-to-week
basis. Are you anti-Pierre Garçon?
Because I'm generally anti-Redskin.
Right. Oh, that's very... Yeah,
anti, pardon my language.
Anti-Washington, really. Yeah. Can we beep?
No, okay. It's too late. It's too late.
Yeah, it's out there. I'm sorry. He's anti-Washington, of course. Well, here's the problem. Everyone jumped on board the Kirk Cousins bandwagon last week. Mm-hmm. Then it got too heavy. So
the wheels on the bus went round and round and then fell off and it crashed into a bunch of people outside of a department store and it was a disaster. It's going to take time for him to be more consistent. And Pierre Garçon is somebody who is not quite talented a wide receiver, a wide receiver to just, like, no matter where the ball is thrown to him, go and get it and build a Calvin Johnson, like, 200-yard game.
Useful last year because he was leading the league in targets, not because he was a great wide receiver.
No.
I don't like his hands. Because
Washington was down 20 points in every game.
I don't like his hands. I don't like any sort of, like, his big play ability. There's nothing that impresses me when I watch him. Like, whoa, Pierre Garçon, did you see what he did? It's someone who got a good free agent contract because of Peyton Manning.
Yep, there's another somebody else, a great quarterback made. He cashed in. You know, he's probably also one of those guys, you know, talks really loud on his cell phone in public, sips his coffee that way, you know, like this.
Yeah.
Totally. And plus, he plays for Washington.
I think that he's in okay play when the Redskins have a good matchup, but I certainly don't like him against Seattle this week.
No, normally I'd give him a wide receiver 2 flex tops.
Yeah.
This week, Benchola.
All right, Butt Stuff wants to know.
Yeah, Butt Stuff.
Monte Ball or Jerick McKinnon in a PPR league? Ooh, Monte Ball is at home, but with facing the Arizona Cardinals. Mm-hmm. Jerick McKinnon, of course, is got a friendlier matchup Thursday night against the Green Bay Packers.
Mm. Well, you know me. I hate starting people on Thursday night in general unless I absolutely have to. And, of course, you're going to start all of your Packers because that's that. And Jerick McKinnon is a high risk, too high reward guy to start on a Thursday night as well.
Monte Ball's been really disappointing.
He's been a part of the RB1 disappointment.
Cardinals are only allowing less than 3 yards per carry.
Mm-hmm. People were wondering if because Monte Ball got the ball so much in that run-oriented Washington offense, Wisconsin offense, started with a W.
Yeah.
That if he didn't take on too much baggage or mileage in college, and he's kind of running like an older man already.
Well, I mean, Le'Veon Bell got just as much work at Michigan State, and he's doing just fine.
That's true. Maybe he's just, is he not good?
I don't know. I haven't seen enough of it. He certainly looked great in college. Yep. I think that with a bye week with Peyton Manning, I got to go with the guy in the Broncos offense versus the guy who has one good game against a terrible defense under his belt, who might not even get that many touches this week.
No, I'd go Monte Ball 100%.
Yeah.
One guy breaks out and has a game against
the Falcons.
The Falcons, who we just talked about are hangover remedies, and now you're going to expect him to. They could be
on a short week.
On a short week.
Rookie quarterback.
Rookie quarterback, rookie running back in Green Bay, with Green Bay picking up momentum now, when they could be down 24-0 in the second quarter.
How many touches is Jerick McKinnon going to get?
Yeah, 6.
All right. Well, so let's go with Monte Ball as a safe bet there, and then we can regret it next week when McKinnon breaks out 2 long touchdowns.
Right, when he and Eddie Royal are hanging out, just looking at us.
Eddie Royal!
Inside the cat, both of us just bump, walking by the coffee shop. Whoa, wish I was in there with you.
Ooh, look at this one. Billy Idol Fan 03.
Nice.
That's just the best handle.
Oh, every day is a good day for a white wedding.
Billy Idol Fan 03 wants to know, and this one's going to cut you deep. Can I drop every Patriot I own? I assume he doesn't own Rob Gronkowski.
You don't drop Edelman, you don't drop Gronkowski, and you don't drop Guskowski.
What about Shane Vereen? I haven't seen him this year.
You bench Vereen if it ends with Ouski, you start him still.
Yeah.
And Edelman, I would put on the bench too until they figure it out, because now everyone's going to be like, oh, I'll just cover him and then worry about LaFell. Now, LaFell was a top 10 wide receiver.
6 for 119.
And a big old touch.
Yeah.
A garbage time touch, no less.
Yeah. I don't think, as much as I would, I like Brandon LaFell. Like, I think that I was, like, into Brandon LaFell for, like, a year or two, a couple years back in Carolina, and then just never really materialized.
These USC receivers really never cut it anymore. I don't know why.
Yeah, I don't trust that school. All right. we talk about good handles here. DuckTales84 wants to know.
My childhood is just tweeting at us.
Should I drop Larry Fitzgerald for John Brown? No.
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 John Brown is not. Listen, he scored in three games.
I don't want to take away what he did in West Virginia, because it was imperative as part of the abolitionist movement.
I was going to say, yeah. as one of the premier abolitionists, John Brown.
Yes, but no, he's
no.
That's great that he's scoring touchdowns. Mm-hmm. That Drew Stanton has a connection with him. Drew Stanton. But no, it's still Larry Fitzgerald. And Larry Fitzgerald has looked better this year than he did last year.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's just a matter of getting him the ball, not having Michael Floyd eyes.
Yeah.
And this week, of course, especially in a week like this, when they could, even though they have an excellent defense, they could give up a lot of points to Denver, and they're going to need to spread the ball around. And Aqib Talib can only cover Michael Floyd, can only cover one receiver at a time.
Yeah.
I love the matchup for Larry Fitzgerald this week. I think actually it could be a huge week for him.
Yeah. We got time for one more.
As a shocker for wide receivers.
Yes, yes. One more question.
Okay.
Let's see. It's a fun one.
It's got to have a good handle, too.
Okay. Well, in that case, let's go with Poony Tunes 18.
Best handles ever. You guys are killing it this week.
Poony Tunes 18 says, is Greg Jennings a terrible play with either Ponder or injured Bridgewater? I don't think he's a terrible play. I take that back. If Ponder plays, if Bridgewater can't play,
mm-hmm.
Every single Viking is a terrible play with Christian
yeah.
Ponder under center.
Mm-hmm.
Might be the least qualified quarterback in the league right now.
It's just terrible. He can't even throw it and reach the line. He can't even reach the line of scrimmage. He's got such a licorice arm. He makes Chad Pennington look like Jeff George. Seriously.
Here's my concern with Bridgewater, though, with Greg Jennings. Last week, Jarius Wright got 10 targets.
Mm-hmm.
Cordarrelle Patterson and Greg Jennings got 4 each.
Mm-hmm.
And so with Jarius Wright suddenly being like, hey, we're the second string buddies who have a rapport.
Just going to say second string buddy factor. We
yeah.
practice together a lot. Therefore,
yeah,
we have that little practice mode.
It's the Kirk Cousins, Niles Paul thing going on
mm-hmm.
there.
Cousins and Paul.
Yep. But with Jarius Wright entering the picture, I do think that gives Greg Jennings a little bit of a hit. I mean, I would have to have a pretty thin roster and a pretty small bench to have to play Greg Jennings.
Fair point. But if you were desperate enough this week, would you start him considering that he's playing Green Bay and guys like that often try to show up in big games against their old
team?
You think
he's going to try to Steve Smith it?
Could he? Is there going to be blood all over the field?
I don't think there's going to be blood all over the field. I think that best case scenario for Greg Jennings would be 80 yards and a touchdown.
Right.
That's not bad. Worst case, like 3 catches for 27 yards.
Best case scenario is you drop Greg Jennings at the most opportune of times when you can let a player go. Hope that he slips through waivers, and in case he's got a good week, no one else is going to want to touch him. You can grab him next week. Make the room on your roster if you need to make a move this week.
Whew, there we go. That's
done again, huh?
Yeah, just like that. Just flies by.
Just
every
gone
week.
In a poony tune of a hot wing time, huh?
Yeah. Folks, thanks for watching us on live stream on SBNation.com, listening to us on Blog Talk Radio, following us on Twitter. I'm at Matt Uffer. That's at Ahoy Nick Stevens. That's about it, right?
That's it. Good luck, everybody. We are now, we've handed off the baton to runner number 2. It's the second lap
yeah.
of the fantasy season. Let's hope maybe some stars emerge and that these guys that we've been looking to finally get back on track do, in fact, get on that track.
All right. Set your lineups and have a great fantasy week. We'll see you next week.
Bye, everybody.